We are now going to move to our second invited speaker, who has a slightly shorter distance to travel. Also an exceptionally energetic human being. When you feel the wind blowing, it's not the trades, it's Michele Aoki, who's just bustling around in Washington State getting things going. Washington State, if you look at their website for the Seal of Biliteracy, you will be blown away by the 3 pages of languages that can be assessed. The number, the hundreds and thousands, I think, now of students who've received the Seal of Biliteracy in Washington State is truly a tribute to Michele's work in bringing people together, many hands working together to make really what we might think impossible happen in a very short period of time. Michele, please.
Thank you so much. It's a tremendous honor to be here, and especially to be among such friends. Madeline Spring, we've worked together a lot on Confucius Institute and dual language immersion over the years. I'm so glad you're here now. And Robert Bleibroman, who was here earlier. We studied Romanian together at the University of Washington, and I visited him and his wife in Romania, in Cluj, and then I went on myself to become a Fulbright lecturer in Romania. So I feel like I've come to a old hometown here. So I'm going to take a moment to get my PowerPoint and some things up. I also would like to just check the speakers. So if you would take a moment to turn to your neighbor and just talk about what have you heard so much? What do you think you need to hear next in terms of where you're at right now in Hawaii? That would be great. Hi, everyone. No, it's good. You need some time just to process and talk and think about what's going on. They've got a very packed schedule today. And there's, as we talked earlier in the weekend, I could take like 5 days probably to try to share everything about our journey in Washington State. So I've tried to pull out some highlights, and I don't want to just duplicate everything that Linda shared, both from her classroom experience and from the experience in Illinois. But at the same time, I do want you to have a sense of where is there commonality in the journeys of the states, because you're one more state, and that the power, I believe, of the seal of biliteracy is when it has a national meaning, and maybe international even. Because if the colleges or businesses find, let me see, if this was a seal that came from Alabama, that's not the same as a seal that came from California and Hawaii. Yeah, they have a really low standard. It helps if we all have a common standard about what we expected to award the seal of biliteracy. So just the words in them, in and of themselves, tell people what it means. So I wanted to begin with my inspiration. First of all, you'll find that if you look at all of those states that are implementing the Seal of Biliteracy, there's almost always some group of people that have been inspired. Certainly, Californians Together and everything inspired a lot of us around the state, around the country. And someone has gotten the idea that this is a good idea and has been willing to go the distance to make it happen. And the distance, we're like water, you know, how you get downstream is different in each state, but we're all trying to get to a similar place. So I wanted to begin my story with my inspiration, who is Galina Zakashanska. She was my daughter's Russian language teacher. Our daughter is not a heritage speaker of Russian, but I have a Ph.D. in Slavic linguistics in Russian. And so she was willing to accept our daughter. Her name is Natalia. She was named after the Russian teacher that both my husband and I had in college, as a matter of fact. And as you probably guessed from my last name, I am not Japanese American, but my husband is. He's a sansei. And so we're a very multicultural family in our own right. In any case, Galina had been teaching kids in the community for a number of years Russian. Most of them were heritage speakers, and a few she accepted who were just second language learners like my daughter. And my husband is the director of the Language Learning Center at the University of Washington. He was actually an office mate with Robert Bleibroman when they were in the UW linguistics program way back when. And he was invited to host the first planning meeting for the first heritage language conference that was going to happen. This was in 1997 that this meeting was held in Seattle. I worked for the state PTA at the time and around parent involvement, and I was invited. I took a lot of notes, and that was really the thing that launched me back into the language profession. As I mentioned, I have a PhD in Slavic linguistics, but you can probably imagine I got those degrees, master's and PhD, at a time when when languages had no future. And so, like many people, especially in linguistics, I went into computer programming. So I was a computer programmer, systems analyst, project manager for about 20 years, and then got back into the language field during this time with the work on heritage languages and then working into dual language immersion around 2000 in Seattle. In any case, Galina, we invited Galina, our teacher, to come to that because she was a heritage language teacher in the community. And we also had a new superintendent of public instruction. Our Department of Education is called the Office of Superintendent of Public Instruction, Terry Bergeson. And so she came to that meeting. And I remember the conversation. Our Russian teacher went to her and she said, you know, Dr. Bergeson, I have students from about 6 or 7 different districts, and they cannot get recognition for their Russian language, even though they have been studying it for many years, and they speak and write and read Russian very well. And if I go to the districts, for each one, there's sort of a different thing. Maybe they would give it alternative learning, maybe this or that. I don't have time to translate all of my curriculum into English or figure out exactly how many hours and how they could earn credits. What can I do? Why can't they have their language, their Russian language, recognized? And Dr. Bergeson said, yes, you are right. This is very important. We must do something. So that was 1997, right? So about 10 years later, in 2008, I actually got hired at the State Office of Superintendent of Public Instruction. Dr. Bergeson was still the superintendent. And this was the first project I work on, how to get languages that students bring with them to school recognized. And as it happened, I had a wonderful colleague who was working for the State Board of Education at that time, Kathy Taylor. And we had worked earlier in 2000 on a project with the Higher Education Coordinating Board. They were interested in what would it look like to not count seat time credits to meet high college admissions requirements, but for example, a portfolio of work. And so there were 3 teams that had worked, one on English, one on math, and one on world languages. And it had been a very interesting process, but where we got to is that it was onerous. If you were going to try to have each local language teacher come up with the portfolio and then somehow pay for them to get together to evaluate, and then how do you actually decide that they really have met the requirement for college admissions? It was a nice idea, but it wasn't practical. So when I came and met with Kathy Taylor at that time, I said one of the big things that has changed is that we have broad consensus in the world language community now about proficiency levels and using the ACTFL proficiency guidelines, and we have world-class assessments. Certainly the ACTFL assessments, which are also used for, in our state and many states, for teacher certification. So the ACTFL oral proficiency interview, OPI, and the writing proficiency test, for example, are being used standardly now across many states for teacher certification. So those tests have been around for a while. They're a bit on the pricey side, but there are new alternatives that had been coming out in the mid-2000s out of the work from the Center for Applied Second Language Studies, CASELS, in the University of Oregon. I think Madeline was probably involved in a lot of those developments with this test that became known as the Standards-Based Measurement of Proficiency, or STAMP. STAMP is an amazing assessment, and I have to say, I think it has transformed the language community because it has offered us for the first time an assessment that's affordable and that covers a range of skills. So you can use STAMP with your beginning language learners all the way up through advanced. It doesn't really go as far as superior, but it goes through the advanced levels. It also covers a range of language skills, reading, writing, speaking, and listening, and it is computer adaptive. So that means that when a student takes the assessment, they get items that are pretty close to what they can do. In other words, it doesn't feel like sitting down to a test that half the items I have no idea what to do. So it's a pretty pleasant experience. So that we had just been working on this, you know, getting more familiar with STAMP at that time, and I presented that information to Kathy. And so she said, great. Competency-based credits is something that our state board wants to work on, and so let's put something together. So in our state, this was, you know, 2008-09, it was before the seal of biliteracy had been born in California. So our journey started with competency-based credits, and it was not an immediate process. We did pilot testing, we had an advisory group with higher ed and K-12 teachers. We had to build a belief that it could actually work and that we could establish levels that would be credible with higher education. So that work had already been in process. I'll tell a little bit more details about it in a moment. But you can imagine, we had a group of people that were already committed to the idea of recognizing languages regardless of when, where, or how you learned them. It's not just what you learned in school. It could be in a community school. It could be a language you brought because you recently immigrated. It could be your Saturday schools. It could be spending a year in Italy, like my niece just did, for example, and just came back and got advanced level on reading and listening, by the way, even though she had never studied Italian before going to Italy. So that process was already in place. The minute we heard about the seal of biliteracy in California, this group of advocates said, we need this for Washington. And we began the work to do that. So we laid a framework for that conversation, and I'm going to tell you a little bit more about that journey, but I wanted to give you the context and the inspiration, because I never forget about this. In fact, I mean, of course, Russian is kind of central in my life in many ways, but I had a chance to speak to a group of Russian families in Bellevue, which is right across the water from Seattle. It's where the general area where Microsoft is, and so there were a lot of folks from that work in Microsoft, for example, there. And I talked to them about our work to recognize languages that students had learned outside of school. And she came up to me, and she was practically crying. She said, thank you, thank you. Our daughter, my daughter's third grade teacher said, there was no point in us teaching our daughter Russian because she'd never get high school credit for it. And so this is the thing that we fight, is this idea in the education community that the only thing that counts is what happened in 6 hours a day over 12 years, 13, if you're lucky to have kindergarten. Okay, so our journey, some of what we'll talk about are, what is it, where did it come from, just the process that we went through in Washington. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail. I won't talk about everything on every slide. I left the information there because this is being videoed. People later might want to refer to it, so I thought it was better to have the information there. And then I hope that we'll be able to share a video that was made as part of the project that I've been involved with that really has a student voice and the family voice about why this makes a difference. I've also taken a stab at answering some of the questions that were offered to me from the Hawai'i roadmap, so we'll see how that goes. So I think this is pretty much what Linda already shared. It's the idea of recognizing both English and one or more languages. I also mentioned that one or more languages. We have a number of students that will definitely qualify for one or more seals. Then there's the nitty gritty, like, okay, well, what is it? Like, where does it go, or how does it do that? And that's something that we grappled with in our state, in our districts over the last, wasn't really quite a year because, and as you'll see in the timeline in a moment, the actual rules for doing the seal were not approved until May, about May 27th or so of 2015. So the first group of seals was just this past June that really happened. But there are mechanics, and I can go into more detail about what everybody did in the afternoon session. Okay, I did want to share a little bit about why the seal is important to Washington, and this was part of a presentation that the person who took my position as World Language Program Supervisor at OSPI last year in 2014 and got the great challenge and honor of actually stewarding the legislation into existence. So these are some things that she shared. First of all, this was in 2011, so it's a lot more now. We had, I think that's like $64 billion of exports. So Washington is the most trade-dependent state in the country, we're always told. About 85% of Boeing planes are sold abroad. We earn about $463 million from visiting students. Agriculture is very big in our state, about $13 billion industry. And those are all business reasons for why we need to be ready to engage with the world. But who is going to benefit from the seal of biliteracy? And that's one of the things that is most exciting to us. First of all, we almost never do anything to equally benefit students who are learning a new language for the first time in school, a lot of the students that Linda has, for example, and students who came to school bilingual, or they came as English language learners. Maybe they didn't even have any English at all. We have not been successful in our systems to recognize those students. At best, we have taken the large number of, say, Spanish speakers in our state, and we've placed them in Spanish 1 or Spanish 2, where they create a complete imbalance, because as false beginners, they make it very difficult for the true second language learners to believe that they will ever learn the language because they can't speak and understand at the rates that the heritage students can. But likewise, when they go into more advanced levels, they have so many missing pieces in grammar and accuracy and literacy that the students that started from scratch and were taught in a very systematic way can outperform them. And then that creates a real identity crisis. How can I be a native speaker of Spanish and you read and write better than me? And you are a native speaker of English and you just started learning Spanish 2 or 3 years ago. So this is really unusual with the seal, that we have something that recognizes students regardless of how they came to school in our programs. We had many partners that helped conceive of and look through the criteria and followed the developments around the country and the development of the seal of biliteracy. One of the first things we looked at in our community, and we really worked hard to bring together our Washington Association for Bilingual Education and our World Language Association, the Washington Association for Language Teaching. And I'm going to say WAFLT a lot because WAFLT is the acronym for that one. Both communities, world language teachers and bilingual ed ELL teachers, agreed that we did not feel that seat time credit should be one of the criteria. That is one of the criteria from California, and it is a reasonable thing to think that 4 years of a language might be a reasonable way to decide that you qualify for the seal. In our state, it was not appropriate because we have no state standards for world languages as far as proficient target proficiency levels. So Spanish 3 in this district and Spanish 3 in that district, French 2 in this classroom and French 2 in that classroom, even down the hall from each other, may produce totally different results. Aside from that, of course, students produce different results. And so in my experience working with immersion programs for over 16 years now, I've seen that even when students started with the same level, nothing, in 2 to 4 to 5 to 6, 7 years, they are radically different. So seat time is not really a very good measure of proficiency. So that was something we all agreed on, and we worked on those criteria and all. But, you know, we were all language teachers and educators and people like that. We didn't really know how to work with the legislature. And personally, I worked for the State Office of Superintendent of Public Instruction, so I was not allowed to work with the legislature. So I actually knew quite a bit about advocacy from my previous life, but I couldn't do anything about it. So we were so fortunate that a nonprofit organization, One America, which is an advocacy organization for organizing communities, they are the top organizing group in Washington State for immigrants and immigrants' rights and refugees. They've worked on the DREAM Act and things like that as well. They took this on as a project. So they found the sponsors in the House of Representatives and in the Senate. And they were able to really steward the bill through. Not only that, they brought students who were benefiting from our work on competency-based credits and would benefit from the seal to come and testify. And there's nothing like getting the student voice in there. It was also extremely helpful because we, you know, at first glance, if you look at the seal and it talks about things like advanced placement and international baccalaureate, that sounds like one more benefit for the advantaged group of students, right? But when you heard directly from students themselves who had come as immigrants, who came with maybe nothing actually, but they had their language and they had the good fortune that their families worked with them on their language. Maybe they got a class that was done in the community. And they were so proud and excited about the opportunity. Then it brought credibility and something that the legislature could support. So the bill that they were able to push through was the Senate Bill 6424. And again, I'm not going to read the whole thing, but you can see that it affirms the benefit of having a language beyond English. This is really critical. It's not just about, okay, here's another certificate. It's going to help you with getting into college. It's really about changing the mindset in our state policy and with our education community and business community about why this is important. Now, I don't know about you guys in Hawaii, but one of the things that's been quite astounding to me, actually, in Washington is that most business people assume that you have to have another language besides English to graduate high school. But it is not a high school graduation requirement in our state, even our district. In fact, I remember there was a radio show some years back. We had at that time in Seattle a superintendent who himself was a native speaker of Punjabi and come to the United States. He came through the business arena and then became a superintendent. And he was asked on the radio, are students required to have a world language to graduate? And he said, yeah, I think they have to have two credits. Yeah, they have to have two credits for college admissions, but not for high school graduation. And so this is one of the big disconnects. Educators are sitting here not doing what we should be doing to support education, and business just assumes that that's what's happening because they can't imagine that we are aspiring to graduate whole classes of students that never had an experience of learning another language. So this is part of the disconnect, is getting people to communicate and helping the business community understand that, you know what, unless we fund it and unless we provide incentives and direction, then it's not going to happen in the education community. It's definitely, we've had almost zero leadership on these things from Washington, the other Washington, D.C. And so it's come from states, and you can see how the West Coast in particular, including Hawaii, that we are some of the leaders to really make things happen. And of course, our friends in Illinois and Indiana, and that's been what's so exciting, is it's across the country, all over the place. So when the bill eventually was brought in, I'll just say, I know we're in a political season right now, so our Senate at that time was majority Republican, but look at that. Yeas were 49, nays were zero. And in the House, which was Democratic, still the yeas, of course, way outweighed the nays. And so it was signed into law by the governor March 27th, 2014. This is the little signing ceremony, and the legislators are there. This student, by the way, had just recently received his certificate for competency-based credits for Arabic. He also could have done Berber in French, but he did Arabic. And so he was very excited. He did get four credits, so he might have been a senior that year, so he probably wouldn't have gotten the seal, but any students that were seniors last year could get the seal, of course. And I just want to point out, this is Roxana Noruzzi, who is our really hero from One America, helping to make that happen. So I just want to emphasize, you cannot do it alone. You need your partners from the business community, from the nonprofit community, from the advocacy groups. But people need to understand what it is and why it's beneficial in order to not be suspicious. So here are a few of the provisions that it has. So it does say that there will be some type of notation. It did require a change to the transcript, which means there has to be rules in the state for how that works. Now, the criteria, wisely enough, in the legislation, they gave it to the responsibility of our state office to decide what the criteria would be. But they did specify that competency-based credits had to be one of the options. So that was a very powerful thing for our state. And the other thing is that they were very concerned about equity issues. And so they wanted to know, this is not something where there's a test that's offered once a year, and if you didn't take it, then you lost that opportunity. You could never earn the seal. So they want multiple opportunities, multiple methods, as flexible as possible to be as user-friendly for students as possible. And furthermore, they wanted to make sure that we understood that we mean, by world language in our state, we mean all natural languages. We don't mean computer languages, which is another bill. They'd like to eliminate world language requirements and just take a couple years of programming instead. So definitely our Native American languages, American Sign Language, and certainly in our competency-based credits model procedure, it specifies that the competency-based credits can be awarded to languages that don't have a commonly available written language, or in the case of ASL, spoken language. Again, the concern is very much about whether we are addressing the wide group of bilingual ed students that we have in our state. So the students that qualify for English Language Learner Services represent probably close to 150 languages in Washington state. And they asked for a report to the legislature. So this is accountability. That means that our state office does need to know who got the seal and what are the proportions. For example, if almost everybody that got the seal was Spanish, what about Vietnamese? What about Somali? What about Amharic and Marshallese and Samoan and so on? So that's a very good thing. They asked for some accountability. And they also wanted to see that we are working, and this is where we are working at a national level, to create more and better ways of assessing language so that it becomes more doable. It's really nice to give stamp tests and pay about $17 a test, but it's really painful when we have to spend over $200 for some of the other languages that are much less commonly taught or tested. So the process of, actually I'm going to get into the criteria in a moment, but I'm going to get a glass of water and let you turn and talk. Now we had legislation in our state, so that was in April of 2014, and so the next step was for the Office of Superintendent of Public Instruction, our Department of Education, to figure out how the actual rules get written that are then available to all schools and districts to implement this. So one thing that was significant in our state about having the legislature pass the bill is that it meant that it was automatically available to all students in all districts. So the districts really have to make it available in one form or another. And so that's a helpful thing. And I love your state, one district. Washington isn't a very big state, right? I mean, we look kind of small up there in the corner. We have 295 districts, with each one has a school board and nothing. Yeah, well, we know California. Okay. Anyway, so the process that the superintendent's office did is convening a seal of biliteracy advisory committee of, again, people that were very similar to the people that had participated earlier in competency-based credits. So people representing higher ed, district-level people, language teachers from a variety of languages, English language learners, specialists, and so on. We met twice. September 2014 was a meeting that I led. I'd actually left the office at that point, was working for Seattle Public Schools, but as my kind of departure activity, I led that committee. And then when they hired the new supervisor, she organized a second meeting in 2015 in February. So the recommended criteria that came out of that, and all of the documentation about the deliberation and all, is on the OSPI website. So you can, if you want the nitty-gritty, you can see that. So we took, like California, we felt it was pretty important to be as close to what California had done as possible. So again, you don't have radically different things. So we followed California's lead in accepting AP and IB tests, not classes, but tests. And you have to pass at least the 3, which is considered passing for AP, or 4 for the IB. And that's the IB SL and HL tests, not the ab initio. We also allowed for, because of the competency-based credits, which set a level of intermediate mid on that actual proficiency scale for competency-based credits, that students that, for example, were in schools that didn't offer AB or IB could take, say, a stamp test, for example, or actual test if that was appropriate. And if they could demonstrate overall intermediate mid proficiency, then they could earn the seal. In other words, no one is held hostage to having access to AP or IB tests. The competency-based credit testing, as you saw, was already part of the legislation. So clearly, anybody that could earn 4 credits, competency-based credits, would be able to earn the seal. We also gave quite a bit of consideration to other national and international tests, in particular the tests from Europe, for example, the DELE from Spain and DELF from France, and also HSK from China and the TOPIK from Korea. And we decided that for the initial launch of the seal in Washington State, that we would not try to introduce those tests. They're a little more complex. They're more expensive generally. They're not offered widely. Sometimes they have just one time a year and so on. But in the future, OSPI can include them. However, they would have to have productive components of writing and speaking. So no test that is just like a grammar test or multiple choice and no production by the student would be acceptable. And then OSPI had to enact the rules, which is called the Washington Administrative Code, which took about a year. So once you know what you want to do, then you have to put it into that legalese. And then there's a whole process of announcing that you're going to make the change and having public forums and blah, 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 blah. So it took a long time. The last meeting, the first meeting was September, the second in February, and it took until the end of May for that process to work itself through. You won't be able to see this very well, but it's on that page, on the seal of biliteracy page at the OSPI office. That just outlines the criteria in a way that maybe is a little bit easier to see visually. So first of all, a student has to be qualified to graduate. We didn't require any additional tests to demonstrate English proficiency because our state requires this, our state test, and now it's the SBAC, and which I think you guys use in Hawaii as well, aligned to the Common Core state standards. So if they meet the graduation requirements for English, we feel that they have demonstrated adequate proficiency in English, both credits that they have to have and also a passing score on our state assessment, which is the national, or one of the 2 nationally available assessments for Common Core state standards, the Smarter Balanced test. So then it comes to the question of how do you demonstrate that you have achieved the level that we expect for the other language besides English, and those are the ones I just outlined for you. IB, AP, competency-based credits, proficiency demonstrated at the intermediate mid-level, and in the future, potentially national or other international tests. So I want to show this little video clip to you. It was made originally in relation to our work on competency-based credits, but it talks about the excitement of the seal of biliteracy coming. And this was actually, the video was made for us because some of our work in the seven districts in South King County, just sort of South Seattle and further south, which have some of the most diverse, certainly the most diverse districts in Washington, and until I think Anchorage now is more diverse, they were the most diverse in the country. They speak to some of the things that the students have benefited from and why they wanted this. So I'm going to just get this video going.
Spanish.
Spanish.
Amharic.
French.
Farsi.
Arabic.
Language is part of our heritage, and it is part of our roots, and it's part of our culture, and it's our everyday life. Giving value to that is always very important in making students always feel welcome and always feel supported.
This is our background. Our language is kind of our representation of who we are. So it was very important for me to teach her Spanish at home. So we speak English here because we're in America, but we come from Mexico, so it's very important for us to know where we come from in our language.
The South King County region is extremely diverse. Just in this region alone, we have over 160 languages, and 40% of our incoming kindergartners are English language learners. The World Language Credit Program officially recognizes students who come into the schools with knowledge of another language. And for many of our kids, this is one of the first times that they've actually been able to get credit and be recognized for a skill that they've learned at home.
I never thought that, like, Amharic would be a language that was known or that I would get credit for, let alone, you know, people knowing of the language. So when I found out about it, I was like, I can't believe my language is being recognized and I get to take this test to get my credit.
Students have the opportunity to earn up to 4 credits. They take exams in reading, writing, and oral. Depending on how they perform, they can earn up to the 4 full credits that are part of their high school graduation credits. It allows them to take other classes that they need because they've already earned these other credits for their language.
It actually builds positive identity in our kids. It connects them deeper to their home language, to their heritage, to their culture, and it allows students to bring their whole selves to the classroom as opposed to leaving who they are at home outside of the classroom. So the World Language Credit Program started in 2 districts in our region, Seattle and Highline. This community impact project called the Roadmap Project is a community effort to raise achievement for our students and close the growing opportunity gap.
The 2 districts that started, Highline and Seattle, it's now expanded to 7 in the Roadmap, plus a number of other large districts around the state that have also embraced the opportunities.
Tukwila School District represents over 80 languages, which is pretty typical for the districts in our area. One of the things that's really fantastic about the program is that it doesn't matter what language you speak, so it offers everyone an opportunity to earn the credits, not just a specific few. All we had to do was recruit the students and make sure that they were there on testing day. From there, it was really easy.
The success of this program really was about collective impact. It was about everyone coming together. So they all embraced it. In fact, they all tested way more kids than we ever envisioned within the very first year, and even more the second year.
We've had over 1,000 students in our region test and get credit for knowledge of their home language. And potentially, this opportunity would be open to the 120,000 students in our region.
When parents find out that we have this program that values their native language and that we're going to give their kids coaching and help them to earn credits toward high school graduation, they're thrilled.
I think it's great that they're bringing in more of the diversity to the schools about letting kids know that it's okay for them to be different and speak another language and actually get credited for it.
And now all the kids who graduate from this year on will have that seal of biliteracy on their diploma when they graduate with those world language credits.
The exam would allow you to get the seal of biliteracy, which is something that I absolutely would love to be able to get accepted into college and have me like as a unique candidate in their campus.
We're part of a global economy, so having kids be able to manifest those skills and have it recognized by the state is really a big deal.
I think it's great because now we're all able to really show our colors, where we come from, how we grew up, and that's through our language. We're able to connect with others as well, and it opens opportunities being able to speak another language and being recognized for that.
I felt honored because that's my language. I don't really use it that often. I just use it at home. At school, I'm afraid to use it. So to have this chance, it was like honoring my language, honoring my people, like not forgetting where we came from. So it was big deal. It was big deal for me and for my family.
It's really exciting. It's innovative, it's different, and it's a way that we've been able to embrace the unique and diverse strengths that our many communities bring to our schools.
Anybody that has a language needs to develop it further and maintain it and be an asset. Those are the opportunities that will really make a difference in kids' lives and the future of the United States.
Aprendan español.
Appris le français.
Amharic in Chalal.
Ta'allam al-lugha al-arabiyya.
Farsi ro yad begir.
Aprende español.
Okay, so I've given you kind of the quick journey. It felt like it took a long time. So to describe it in about 20 minutes, you know, it's you're collapsing a lot of things that took time. It wasn't all start and stop. It took time to find legislators who would actually see it through. Now the great news for you guys is that you are ready. You're already poised. You don't have to do that part. So you're now at the stage of what does it look like to actually implement it, make it happen. And that's a little more like the situation in Illinois. So it's interesting that some states have started more from getting the legislation or the rules or the state board or whatever, and then now they have to figure out how they're going to implement. In our state, it took longer to get that official part of it done, but we had a lot of buy-in already on the idea and why it would be done and the benefits and so on. So here's some of the questions that were given to me from Hawaii. I'm just going to go through these quickly and we'll expand on them. Maybe I'll stop after each one, or some of them are more substantive than others. So as I described earlier, the legislation passed in 2014, so the rules for the criteria were not established until May 2015. So a lot of the questions about impact and so on, we can't answer yet because this is really the first year that the state is sort of officially going to be administering it. What was the process? I described that building of consensus. We started back in 2012 after we heard about the seal of biliteracy in California. Some of the strongest advocates, interestingly, were our partners from the Kingdom of Spain. We have an agreement with the Kingdom of Spain that brings teachers to our state, and also from the Cervantes Institute. They asked for a meeting with our superintendent. We met with them. He promised. Unfortunately, I shouldn't say that, but anyway, it did not make it into the legislative agenda that year, but the following year, with the advocacy of people who really cared in the community, it did make it onto the legislative priority list and was passed. So we reached out to we also had a list of all the supporters that we collected over about a year, and that's where we really went to the universities and got provosts and presidents and deans and people like that to sign on so that people would believe, the business community would believe that the university was paying attention. And then, as I said, One America really deserves the credit for really getting the bill passed. I think that's enough on process, wouldn't you say, at this point? Great. Okay, so how are you doing now? Like how many awarded and how many languages and so on? So as I mentioned, that those rules, the Washington Administrative Code, didn't get established until 2015. So those of us districts that had been collecting names and were wanting to do this, we scrambled. We could not really take action until it was officially ready from the point of view of legal status. And so then we worked madly in order to pull together the names of the students that would qualify for those different criteria, AP exams, IB exams, and the competency-based credits. So example, in Seattle, we, in that couple weeks period before they all graduated, came up with 195 students, 84 via AP exams, 52 via IB, and 59 for competency-based credits. We had 17 languages for the seniors last year, and 10 high schools, which is pretty much all of our comprehensive high schools in Seattle were represented. And not all high schools offer AP and IB, so there are many students that
that got it through competency-based credits. One thing I should just mention is that AP and IB exams are given in May, so the results don't come out until the summer. And so the students that earned it last year were ones who would have taken AP or IB in their junior year. Now, we can still, based on the national guidelines, and we had quite a discussion about this, you can, after a student graduates, they can still receive the seal as long as the testing happened before the graduation date. So we're now trying to go back and figure out who actually were seniors last year who did AP and IB over the summer, and got their summer results so that they can also get the seal. You ask about how we get the word out to the community, to parents, to employers. Obviously, with such a short time frame, you can imagine we were scrambling. So we sent letters to counselors. We sent letters home to the students that we identified. We gave generic letters to the counselors to give to students whose families had not received the letters. People often move or addresses don't get updated and so on. And we worked on, that's sort of just to get the word out initially around that. We just held about a week ago a World Language Summit, the High School to College Connection at the University of Washington, with over 100 participants. This was one of our projects from our University of Washington Star Talk program. And so we had a lot of partners from the university Title VI centers and all that participated in that. And we haven't really tackled the employers yet. I see that we're about out of time. I'll just remind you of questions that are here in case those are ones that you might want to refer to later. And a lot of questions about assessment, and I'll talk more about that in the afternoon. So with that, maybe there's time for one or two more questions from the audience. Okay, great.
Please join me in thanking Michele. And once again, we would like to allow time for questions.
Hi, Sun? Yeah. I noticed with the legislation, maybe it was the House side, there was a significant amount of opposition, not on the other House. And I'm curious for Illinois as well, what's the nature of the resistance to adopting such a policy?
I think there's sort of two main kinds of resistance that we experienced over that period of months while the legislation was working its way through. Number one, I have to say, unfortunately, is a continued view that learning another language is a lower priority than learning STEM, learning computer science, learning math, learning English language arts, and a misunderstanding, a not knowing of the data that shows that with English language learners, they are more successful in English and academically when they continue to develop a home language. And so the assumption is that it's going to be more successful if we spend more time in English and more time taking more math and computer science classes, that that's what is needed in the world. They're just, I have to say, ignorant of the reality that we are the only country in the world that aspires to be monolingual. And every other country that we're competing with is not going for bilingual. They're going for multilingual in many languages. And they never stopped with science or the arts. I was just in visiting our schools and partner schools in China in November, and they are paying all attention around emotional behavioral things and the arts and things like that. So they're not making it an either or choice. They feel they can do well in math and science and the arts and work on social emotional growth and learn at least one or two or three languages. So that's one attitude, is that continued attitude. It may not show up in a policy like required English only, but it's that mentality. That's one thing that's sad. The other one actually came from a different quarter. It's from people themselves who have heritage connections. Maybe they have a heritage language. Often they don't have that heritage language. So they're kind of protective of whatever the condition of their home language is. And they're afraid to subject their children or students of that language to testing for fear that they will fail. Now, what we've proved is that they didn't. We have so many Samoan and Marshallese and Oromo and Tigrinya and any number of language students, Vietnamese in particular, have done a stellar job. Many of them are at the advanced levels. Over 50% of the students generally, 40 to 50% across our state, have earned 4 credits. This is a level of proficiency, intermediate, mid, that we rarely can get our students to in the K-12 system unless they have a really outstanding immersion type of program. So the students have surprised us. The other thing that has surprised us is that the tests, even though many of them, like ACTFL tests, are designed for adults and professionals, some of them, like the ALTA tests, are used pretty widely by businesses. So they were not catering to a K-12 student, but the students are still being successful, even when they're given prompts about things that they really don't have experience with, buying a house. They have surprised us. They can still demonstrate a level of proficiency that is adequate for earning credits. And so I think it's just understandable. It's a lack of trust. It's a lack of experience. And there's no way to overcome that other than just trying and seeing. The other thing is the concern that, of course, there are going to be students that have speaking skills but don't have literacy skills. And I think it is our imperative to remedy that situation by offering them opportunities. So one of the things that we did was, for example, an after-school Vietnamese program pilot for students at the middle school level, and we invited them in. And it said, you know, do you speak Vietnamese? Would you like to work on your reading and writing? And so they came in. I had like 27. I thought I'd have 11. 27 kids came in. About three or four really didn't know Vietnamese at all, but they kind of had Vietnamese connections. Maybe their parents were Chinese speakers who had come from Vietnam. They thought they should know Vietnamese. So I said, well, we're not really prepared for you. But of the others, there were about nine or so, six to nine, that actually were very proficient at reading and writing, and others that felt like they couldn't read and write at all. So over 6 weeks, we explored with them how to help them take steps to work on developing their reading and writing proficiency. And so, you know, I know that can work. It takes effort, and it will definitely take collaboration with the community to build the resources. It won't happen mostly in the school day. It's going to be an out-of-school time. But those were the two main things. So the continued belief that we don't need more languages, and the belief among people that have multiple languages access that they're not ready to expose their languages to things like earning credits or being tested, that it could be a bad experience. In fact, it's been a good experience, as you heard from those students.
Thank you.
And do you want to add about Illinois?
In Illinois, it was unanimous on both sides of the aisle. And we initially had some kind of pushback. In our case, it was on the Republican side because they were concerned that it was an initiative that was catering more to our English language learners. And we had just in the previous year passed a huge funding piece, which is actually unusual in Illinois to fund anything, but it was to support English language learners. And so they thought we were just kind of, that it was almost a repeat. And so it was about educating them to say that this is what this is about. And as it turned out, one of our biggest proponents now is one of the Illinois senators that was on the Republican side, who originally was against, who says, no, our business community needs this, and we need this to be really supported and expanded. So I think a lot of it has to do with the advocacy role that we play in terms of really explaining what it is, and more importantly, what it can do for our students and the impact it can have on our states.
I have a question about the literacy part. Can you talk a little bit about the level of literacy that's being evaluated?
Mm-hmm. So I guess, again, the context in Washington is that we started with competency-based credits. So students can earn from 1 to 4 credits. They have to be at least novice mid to earn 1 credit, and novice high to earn 2, intermediate low for 3, or intermediate mid for 4. That's a really high standard compared to seat time standards, but and a truly proficiency-based assessment. But we felt it was important not to make it seem like it was easier to get credits through competency-based credit testing. So based on the scale that Linda presented to you earlier, at the novice level, students are using formulaic language. They can write in lists, they can write phrases that are familiar to them, and so on. So honestly, we've had just a teeny tiny handful of students that have earned 0 credits. That's different from the CEAL, which has to be at the 4 credit level, but still, it means they do come with something of value. So some percentage, but not that large, earn maybe 1 credit, and it could be a variety of reasons for that. But at the novice level, they have to be able to produce some things in writing. So if you asked them about, like, tell us about your favorite lunch to have at school, or something like that, or at work, or wherever it would be, then they might list, you know, sandwich, apple, eat chips, or, you know, things along that line. And they might start to have, I like to eat chips, I like to eat sandwich, I like to eat pizza. So it's very formulaic, not a lot of different forms of sentences and so on. At the intermediate levels, they're creating with language, and they're writing in sentences, maybe series of sentences, but they still might not have a paragraph kind of holding together, cohesiveness. In other words, it's not extremely demanding to get to an intermediate mid in a writing form. The reality is that among heritage learners, there are many who can speak at the advanced level and can barely write at the novice level. You know, you think, why don't you just write down what you just said and then you'd have a paragraph? But, you know, honestly, you write at the level that you feel comfortable, that you've had experience. But obviously, if you already have a spoken language, the trip from where you're at to where you want to be is a lot shorter than when you're starting with no language at all. So it's quite doable, and we do have many students, as I said. Even I've had a 14-year-old Russian student that I believe he was even born in this country, he's a heritage speaker, but quite brilliant, but he got superior on actual oral proficiency interview, computer-based, and writing proficiency tests. So even those very challenging tests for adults, the students really are surprising at how well they can do. I should have mentioned one more thing. We talk about reading, writing, listening, and speaking. And ideally, you'd have assessments that allow you to see all of those things. Some assessments are like STAMP, for example, are what we call presentational mode. So presentational writing. There's a prompt and you write. It would be like writing a letter or email or something like that. Or the speaking is like a situation. It's like you're introducing yourself and telling about your interests or something of that sort. So there's not an interaction. There are other tests like the Apple test from ACTFL that have a simulated conversation. So there's an avatar, you know, like, how are you feeling today? Oh, I'm fine. How about you? Oh, well, and what are you going to do this afternoon? You know, they make it feel like a conversation so that could feel more comfortable to students. And of course, for a number of the languages, we use tests that are done by as a telephone interview. And my experience with heritage learners is that they generally are very comfortable with that format. They have not had problems with the oral interviews that are done by telephone. They do very well. Some students are intimidated by technology. That's why it's important to have different options so that you can really make choices about how to best administer the tests. Our goal is always to try to cover all of the skills, but we have to be realistic, and we don't want to deny languages simply because no one has been able to develop a reading test in Amharic for us so far. And so we do say that the key thing is a writing production and a speaking production. And of course, in the writing, we expect that they're going to read their own writing and make corrections and things like that. So in a sense, they also have access to reading. It's their own writing, but still there's a reading component in that sense. And same in the listening. If they've recorded something they've spoken, they can listen to it and make adjustments, re-record, and so on. So there is an aspect to listening in it, even though it's not tested separately for those languages. So I'm talking about the kinds of tests that we use for languages like Somali and Amharic, Punjabi, Oromo, Tigrinya, and so on.
This is just in answer to Luan's question earlier about opportunity, you know, in the workforce and so on, and you just mentioned that. Until recently, I was head of international banking for Bank of Hawaii, and all of the officers that I hire have to have at least one foreign language, Asian language preferably, because we deal with a lot of customer coming from Asia. And Hawaii itself is very dependent. The economy here is very dependent on tourism. And one of the things I notice when I travel overseas is that most of the countries in the world, their tourism industry is very strong because they do have language speakers to help greet, you know, their customer and so on. At the airport, you name it, airport have like multi-language to the point where it's annoying because you hear translation five different languages for any announcement. But here, even Hawaiian Airlines had a difficult time recruiting people who can speak Japanese and Chinese, for example, because there's just not enough people here who can speak those languages. And I must say I'm embarrassed when I travel on that airline, when I go to China, for example, because the level of Chinese is so bad. And the misconception is we have a lot of Chinese here, but they don't speak Mandarin. They speak primarily Cantonese. And the target market for Hawaiian Airlines for China is Mandarin speaking. And therefore, there is a dearth of Mandarin speaker here in Hawaii. You know, so for me, it's very important, actually, that our students start from the time they're young until they get to a level where they can really speak the language and communicate. There are a lot of opportunity for that, and I can speak at length about how the European organize their school system so that language is part of it. They don't focus on just 5 or 6 subjects a day. It's based on a biweekly type of schedule where certain elective classes are only taught once every 2 weeks, you know, arts and home economics and things like that. But language, it might not be every day, but it would be 2 times or 3 times a week that they would learn that. You know, even their primary language, they would vary so that it's philosophy one day, literature another day, and writing, reading, and writing another day. So you're not neglecting your primary language either. But so there is a way of really mixing all of that so that we have a more fully developed curriculum for the students.
Thank you, Betty.
Good. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Michele. We have time now for a break so everybody can fill their coffee cups and their stomachs a little bit. And then we will have 3 gentlemen who will share with us about the business in Hawaii and language opportunities there and speak to the value of how, again, the 2 hands, how language opens up that awareness that gives you the edge, so to speak. Thank you very much, Michele.
Thank you.